Hashim, and this is the Sudanese Surgical Club for International Surgical Webinars. It is an honor to present today Dr. Samra Junker, a consultant surgical gastroenterologist and advanced laparoscopic surgeon at Symbiosis University Hospital and Research Center at Pune, India, and is going to present the topic speaking about current concepts in carcinoma rectum. We are proud to have you between us, sir, and we hope we have a good time. Thank you very much. You may start.
Thank you. Thank you. Good evening. Thank you, Sudanese Surgical Club. I thank for Professor Ahmed, Professor Hussein, and Professor Mohammed, who has given me opportunity to present today this wonderful evening. I am talking on current concept of CA rectum. Myself, Dr. Samrat Junker. I am consultant surgical gastroenterologist in Symbiosis University Hospital. This is a hospital where I work. And this hospital is a part of the university. University is having more than 20 different branches. And our motto is Vasudevam Kutumbakam. That's world is a one family and education should go on. Near about 40,000 students will be there at any time in the campus. I bring greeting from Symbiosis University Hospital and Research Center, Pune, India. So we'll talking today on the rectum. Rectum, in fact, I am audible. Should I go ahead, sir? Mohammed, sir?
Yes, you can go ahead, sir.
Yeah. We'll be talking mainly on the CA rectum. Rectum is a part of large intestine. In fact, it is a end 15 centimeter of the part of the large intestine. But anatomically, it is the continuation of the large intestine. If you take all other factor in case of malignancy, it will be completely different. If you see, rectum is the last 15 centimeter, which is most compact organ, which is sitting in the deep pelvis, which is difficulty for surgeon to operate. And part of the rectum is intraperitoneal, part of the rectum is extraperitoneal. In fact, it also increases challenge for the surgeon while doing the surgery. And also rectum is related with posteriorly vessel, major vessel, laterally ureter, anteriorly bladder, and also in the male, it's a prostate and seminal vesicle, in the female, uterus, vagina, and ovary. So if you take overall, a rectum is a one part which is sitting in the deep cavity, which surrounded by the many organs and operating on the cancer, preserving proper oncological principle, it's a bit complicated. So we have to deal rectum as a separate entity as compared to colon. If you take a rectum, the one of the initial study which has been done in 1980, they have mentioned that colon cancer overall survival is 25%. Local recurrence, in fact, it is less, 5%. But if you take a rectal cancer, overall survival is 50%. It is quite good, but local recurrence is a major challenge. In 1980 period, that is perineal proctectomy, all the procedure which has been done in the early 90s or mid 90s, which were related with a more local recurrence. So we have to concentrate on the rectum separately to deal, because it's a completely different anatomical organ with having its own characteristic, different characteristic. The major concern related to rectal surgery, if you do the rectal surgery, we are having in early part of the 20th century, there were a high morbidity. Around 38 to 40% of morbidity has been noted in the literature. Mortality is around 1 to 5%. The incontinence was also higher rate. The risk of anastomotic leak because of complex vascular structure and also Sudeik point and Grippis point, which is also on the higher side. The APR rates were very high. Two decades back, APR rates were more. And also urinary dysfunction, sexual dysfunction is also higher side. Last but not the least, local recurrence, which is a major concern in rectal surgery. But over last 2 to 3 decades, lot of new advances has happened in the rectal surgery, in domain of surgical therapy, in domain of shifting from adjuvant to neoadjuvant concepts of the radiation. Hello, sir. In shifting radiation from adjunct to neoadjunct, and also the Mercury trial, which has given the MRI, pre-op MRI to decide. So last three decades, we are able to decrease the morbidity, decrease the mortality rate, incontinence has gone down with the presence of ICG and good anatomical knowledge of the vascular structure. We have decreased the leak rate, we have decreased the APR. In fact, this decade, APR rate is very less. And also we are able to decrease the local recurrence. But these are the main concerns: sexual dysfunction, urinary dysfunction, and related mortality. These are a bit on the higher side. So current goal of the rectal surgery is to give the good quality of life, preserve the sphincter, but without compromise the oncological outcome. That's the current goal of the rectal surgery. So last decade, we had three major impactful changes in the rectal cancer management. First is the evolution of imaging. In fact, we should be thankful for the Mercury group, which has come with the Mercury 2 trial also. They are able to give a imaging in a such a way that we can decide what way we have to plan the surgery radiation. And second one is the evolution in the radiation. That's radiation shifting from the adjunct to neoadjunct, from the neoadjunct long course to short course to totally neoadjunct. Lot of things are happening in the radiation zone. And also the TME surgery, that is proper plain surgery, which is removing the total rectum in toto. These three has made lot of changes in the rectal cancer management. So with this, we'll start our topic of rectal cancer management today. A disclosure, lot of concepts and imaging I have taken from the standard textbook, Shackelford, Sabiston, and ACRS. And few of the images I have taken from the internet article, Google. Wherever images are there, I try to give a due credit. But some of the images I couldn't find the proper citation. But without those images, today's topic of presentation of surgical anatomy and other thing would not be possible. So there is impact of these images. For today's topic, considering the mixed crowd, as discussed with these members, they told more of the resident and also consultant practicing. So I tried to be on the both side. I'll start with the surgical anatomy. We'll get the bit of staging and radiation of the CA rectum and TME concept, surgical concept, pathological review of the specimen, local excision, and wait and watch. So imaging, mainly imaging, I thought it is a bit of big topic, we should take a separate lecture. So I am not touching the imaging in this present topic. So surgical anatomy of the rectum. Rectum is the last part of the large intestine, which is around 15 to 17 centimeter. It begin when colon reaches the sacral promontory. The transition is marked mainly by absence of tinea coli and absence of appendicular epiploike. The wall of Wistron, that is noted by the endoscopist, there are three mainly, left, right, and left. The most prominent is middle wall, which clinical significance is to anti-reflection of peritoneum we can detect on the adjacent to middle wall. These are not wall, these are mainly fold, no specific function. When you completely do the TME procedure, we can completely mobilize the rectum, they will be lost. And in this maneuver, we can add additional 5 cm of length to the rectum. The rectum is mainly divided in three parts, mainly basically based on the peritoneal reflection. The lowermost part, 0 to 7 cm, it is a completely extraperitoneal and it's a most difficult part to handle if there is a malignancy. Middle part is 7 to 12 cm covered by the peritoneum anteriorly only, lateral and posteriorly, it's a no peritoneum. And upper part, which is covered anterior laterally, extend from the 10 to 15 centimeter. So there, the rectum, if we see here, it's upper rectum. Sorry. The upper rectum is mainly having the peritoneum, which is covering anterior and the laterally. The mid rectum is having only anterior covering. There is no much lateral covering of the peritoneum. And lower rectum, which is devoid of the peritoneum. And also you can see the mesorectum, that is a yellow, which is also very less in the lower rectum. That's the main crux of the difficult in management of lower rectal cancer. The anatomy of the mesorectal fascia. Mesorectal fascia is contained fascia propria for the mesorectum. Mesorectum, which is having the enclosed by the mesorectal fascia, which contain the fat, lymphatic, nerve, blood vessel, and surrounded by the, if you see here, the dark zone, which is surrounded by the avascular plane, there is a cobweb appearance. If we start doing the TME cobweb or angel hairs, we'll get if we go in the proper plane in the mesorectal, outside the mesorectal fascia. The mesorectum is asymmetrically distributed. Anterolaterally, the tissue of the mesorectum is thinner, and posteriorly, bulk of the tissue will be there. It will form the two buttocks or mesorectal cheeks on the posterior aspect. The rectal wall is covered by the mucosa, submucosa, innermost, muscular propria. This is the mesorectum. This part is the mesorectum. This is the most important, which decides the what kind of therapy we need to, and which is enclosed by the mesorectal fascia. This is the covering of the mesorectal fascia. We can appreciate nicely in this image of axial section of the rectum. Last 1 or 2 centimeter of the mesorectum, in fact, that is the lowermost part of the CA rectum, which we have seen, and which is the most complicated, because here the mesorectal fascia, mesorectum is very less. If you see here, mesorectum is very less as compared to upper part. So because of this, when tumor crosses the muscular layer, it will be the very much close for later. Inaccurate dissection at this level can lead anteriorly breach, which causes the local recurrence. If you go more posteriorly, tearing up the presacral fascia, which will cause torrential bleeding, which is very difficult to handle bleeding during the rectal surgery. So we have to be in the proper plane. Presacral fascia, this is the thickened portion of the endorectal fascia, which is covering the sacrum, which is covering the presacral veins and the hypogastric nerve. If we go inside, we may land in bleeding, or we may lead to injury of the nerves. Retrorectal or Waldes fascia. Waldes fascia is nothing but the fascia, thickened part of the fascia, which originated at the S3-S4, extend anteriorly to the fascia propria, and it is 3 to 5 centimeter above the anorectal junction. If you see, this is a presacral fascia, this is fascia propria posterior. It is connecting between the two thickened band, thickened fold, which is the Waldes or retrosacral fascia. The importance of this fascia, if we do the dissection, this is a retrorectal space, this is a supralevator space. This, until and unless we divide, we will not make the complete rectal mobilization. Inherently, we have to sharply incise during the TME to connect the both spaces, and we go to the levators. So here they divided. After division only, we are able to go till down to the levator flow. Dinonvillous fascia, it is an anterior fascia which extend deeper part. If you take a part of the posterior superior part of the bladder, it extends from the rectovesical pouch to the pelvic floor down to the pelvic floor. Here in the male, we can see that it separate between the prostate and seminal fascicle from the rectum, that is prostatoperineal membrane. This is the part of dinonvillous fascia which is separating the prostate and seminal vesicle from the rectum. This is the dinonvillous fascia. In case of the female, it is a thin rectovaginal fascia which separates the rectum from the vagina, that is rectovaginal septum. If you see in this diagram, this is the vagina, this is the part of the rectum, it is the rectovaginal septum, that is nothing but the dinonvillous fascia. Lateral ligament, it is also one of the important anatomical marker we have to know during the rectal surgery. The lateral ligament, which has been mentioned by my initial authors, but during the Bill Hill TME, he told laterally we have to be in the proper plane. The importance of this fascia, if it is a malignancy, we have to be bit lateral, but we should not injure the nerve on the lateral aspect. It is one of the area where nerve get injured. If it is a benign, we stick to medial side. If it is a malignance, we have to go beyond the denonvillous, and in fact, we have to be proper at the place. And some of the time, 20% of the time, middle rectal artery will be there in the lateral ligament. the vascular supply of the rectum, we need to understand that on the left side, inferior mesenteric artery, which gives the branch to the left colic ascending branch and then sigmoidal and the suprarectal artery. The interconnecting branch between the middle and middle colic, the left branch of middle colic or accessory branch of middle colic with the ascending branch of the left colic or the middle colic root, that is the arc of Reylon, we need to understand, because some of the patient, the domont connection may not be there, that Sudeik point will be there around 50% of the patient. In those, main supply is from the arc of Reylon. If we damage this, the chance of having the vascularity of the conduit will be more. So may rectum, in fact, rectal supply, it's a robust rectal blood supply. The main issue is not with the rectal blood supply. Main issue is the conduit after division of the sigmoid colon. The conduit, what we anastomose colon with the part of the rectum or anal canal, that vascularity of the conduit is important. So the conduit, in fact, few author has mentioned that there are intercommunicating three levels will be there. One is marginal artery of Doman, which will present in the near the mesocolon around 2.5 centimeter, which is supplying the interconnecting branches. And arc of Reylon, they mentioned that it is connection between the superior mesenteric and inferior mesenteric vessel. And most medially, few of the author has mentioned that is meandering artery of Moskowitz. And few of the author will tell that it is nothing but the dilated part of the arc of Reylon. The most important anatomical factor we need to understand here is, if we are going for ultra-low resection or if we are going for TATME, where we need to mobilize the splenic flexure completely. In view of mobilization of splenic flexure, we have to divide the inferior mesenteric vein as high as possible at the lower margin of the pancreas. In those scenario, the inferior mesenteric vein will be along the arc of Reylon. If we go inadherently bit on the lateral side, if we injure arc of Reylon and patient is also having Sudeik point where intercommunicating connection are not there, it is the major supply. In those period, the lowermost part of the conduit will go into the necrosis, avascularity. So we have to be careful on the lateral aspect of the division of the inferior mesenteric vein. We should be at the level of the lateral margin of inferior mesenteric vein. So the low ligation and high ligation also an important concept in case of rectal surgery. What does it mean high ligation? If you take a division of the left colic, if we clip the inferior mesenteric artery above this left colic is a high ligation. If we clip below this origin of left colic is a low ligation. Low ligation is IME is ligated before the origin of left colic artery, and high ligation high ligation is before the origin of left colic. Low ligation is after the origin, below the origin of left colic. More lymph node will be harvested in the high ligation. In case of low ligation, poor lymph node yield will be there. The risk of hypogastric nerve damage is more in case of high ligation, and conduit length will be issue in low ligation, because the if you ligate lower side, the tethering of the mesorectal fascia will be there with the retroperitoneum, which is not get completely mobilized. So conduit will not reach. So the low ligation versus high ligation, as per the evidence, it doesn't make big benefit oncologically doing high ligation. But if we are planning for ultra low, intrasplenic or TATME, we need to mobilize the splenic fixture. In that period, we have to do the high ligation, then only possibility of the complete mobilization of the descending colon with mesocolon and splenic fixture may be possible. Drainage of the lymphatic, the above the pectinate line, everything drain into the hypogastric internal iliac node, and below that it will go to the inguinal node. Importance is, if it is a low rectal malignancy, we need to know about the nodal inguinal nodal status also. The venous drainage is drainage of the vein through the inferior mesenteric vein. If you see here, this is inferior mesenteric vein. Below the lower margin of the pancreas will do, and arc of Reylon will be lying here. We should not injure the arc of Reylon during ligation of the inferior mesenteric vein. the complete venous drain is the suprarectal vein will be there, which is going to continuation of the inferior mesenteric vein, and middle and the lower rectal vein which drain into the internal iliac vein. Nerve supply, sympathetic nerve supply originate at the level of T12L1, and they form the close proximity origin of IMA anterior to the pre-aortic area multiple flexors. So if you are planning for, if we are planning to do high ligation, then also we should be at least 1 centimeter away from the origin, because that origin of the inferior mesenteric, at the root of the inferior mesenteric, there will be a rich flexus of hypogastric, superior hypogastric flexus. And from there, which enters down and divide at the sacral promontory into the two equal bundles and enter in as a right and left hypogastric flexors into the pelvis. Parasympathetic nerve, hypogastric flexors which run on the posterolateral wall of the pelvis join with the parasympathetic nerve, that is, form the inferior. After joining, they form the inferior hypogastric flexors, that is a pelvic flexors. And parasympathetic nerve originate at the level of S2, S3, S4 and also gives the nervi esgenti. Superior hypogastric flexus, also known as a presacral flexus, inferior hypogastric flexus is a pelvic flexus or nervi esgenti. Superior hypogastric flexus is contain the sympathetic only, but inferior hypogastric flexus contain both sympathetic and parasympathetic. Damage during mainly ligation of the IMA, if you go more towards the root and if we are mobilizing on the lateral aspect of the pelvis. And inferior hypogastric flexors damage on the lateral stalk division or anterior mobilization at the level of the denonulus. Injury to the superior hypogastric flexors leads to urinary incontinence and retrograde ejaculation. Inferior hypogastric flexors leads to impotence and atonic bladder. In case of female, it decreases the orgasmic intensity. And if it is an inferior hypogastric, it lubrication dysfunction will be there. The rate of bladder and erectile dysfunction after rectal surgery is as high as around 50%. Probable site of injury for the inferior hypogastric is on the while doing the lateral mobilization or anterior mobilization. Anterior mobilization. Here we have to take a denonvillus along with the specimen in case of the rectal malignancy to avoid the positive margin. In those scenarios, we should stick towards the denonvillus. If we go bit of outside, chances of injury to the inferior hypogastric flexus will be more, which should be avoided. The staging of the CA rectum. The rectum staging is divided into four. If we take a T1, which will be only limited to submucosa, T2 is invading the muscularis propria, T3 is invading into the pericolorectal tissue. That's the most important in case of the rectum, that is a mesorectal invasion. And T4 is nothing but invading to the visceral peritoneum, wherever peritoneum is there, upper or middle part of the rectum, or adjacent organ, bladder, prostate, or seminal vesicle in case of the lower part. The most important T3 aspect, which has been not still added into the AGCC or NCCN, but Europeans has been proposed that T3 is the most important crux of management of the CA rectum. That T3 stage, they divided as a mesorectal invasion. If we see here, the mesorectal invasion. The T3, 1 centimeter less than 1 mm is a A, 1 to 5 mm is a B. If it is going beyond 5 mm is a C, and if it is going beyond 15 mm is a D. And T3 can be again classified as a mesorectal positive, which is going less than 1 mm of the mesorectal fascia. This is a mesorectal fascia. This part is a mesorectum. And how much it is involving the mesorectum, that grade can be labeled as a T3ABC. That's the most important concept for our management of the tumor, T3 tumor, rectal tumor, locally advanced rectal cancer. Regional node, nodal status may be N1 or N2. N1A is involving one node. N1B is 2 to 3 node. N1C is no nodes, but there is a tumor deposit on the non-peritonized surface of the colon or rectum. N2 is 4 to 6 node positive node, N2B is 7 or more nodes in the mesorectum. Distant metastasis, it may be M1 involving one organ without peritoneal mets, M1B is 2 or more organ without peritoneal mets, M1C is peritoneal surface mets with or without other surface or other organ metastasis. Radiation concepts in CA rectum. Long course chemo-RT, I think it's a well standardized. I think most of the center follows the long course chemo-RT till last few years. The long course chemo-RT is nothing but a chemo radiation as a first, as a new adjuvant. In this preoperative 5FU based chemo-RT will be given, and around 1.5 gray of radiation every day, Monday to Friday for 5 day, and 2 day week will be gap. This cycle will continue for 5 weeks, and total radiation around 50 gray with following 5.4 gray booster dose will be given. Infusional 5FU or capacitabine will be given at the start and at the end of the radiation cycles. Around 45 to 50 gyri in 25 to 28 fraction chemo radiation will be given. After that, TM will be done. Surgery will be followed around 6 to 8 weeks later. Followed by rest of the cycles of chemotherapy is supposed to be completed. It's a complete standard care. It's nothing but chemo radiation followed by TME, and chemotherapy is a part of long course chemo-RT. Benefits of long course chemo-RT mainly three. One is 50 to 60% of downstaging tumor. If suppose it is a T3B tumor is there, it will become T2 tumor. That is a downstaging. Around 20 to 30% they have seen pathological complete response after giving long course chemo-RT and waiting for 6 to 8 weeks. And also they have noticed that length of the tumor, if it is a mid-rectal tumor, it will shrink and become the low rectal tumor, or it is upper rectal tumor, may extend until the upper rectum, it will shrink and go down. So downsizing also has been seen, the effect of long course chemo-RT. Short dose chemo-RT, which is most convenient and cost effective way of giving radiation, that is now getting popularized with availability of rapido trial. The radiation will be given initially 5 gray per fraction for 5 consecutive days, high dose of radiation, shorter duration of period, subtotal of 25 gray will be radiated within 5 days. Around 7 to 10 days waiting and early surgery. Patient will be free from the problem within 15 days. So the main advantage of giving short course radiation against the long course is it's a cost effective, because cost of stay around 1.5 months, patient roaming around, all the thing will be decreased drastically. Patient will be happy because he is get rid of the all the problem, otherwise has to wait for 3 months for long course and surgery, that will be get rid of. And the toxicity of chronic toxicity will be reduced in case of short course, and patient will start early chemotherapy within 1 month. In fact, in case of long course, we are only dealing with the sterilization of the local field. We are forgetting about the metastatic component of the locally advanced CA rectum. So if we are going for short course, the chemotherapy can be started within a 1 month of period of starting a treatment. If we take a crux of long course is the 1 to 6 weeks, we are giving 1 to 5 weeks, we are giving daily radiation and also giving 5-fluorouracil infusional or capacitabine at the start or at the end of 5 weeks, and around 6 to 8 weeks, we are waiting, followed by we are doing the proper TME, and followed by completing within 1 month, 21 days, or surgical wound once heals, with stoma or without stoma, will plan for the chemotherapy, and chemotherapy will be completed rest of the cycle. After that, if at all stoma is there, closure can be decided. That's the crux of long course. In short course, in short to understand, we'll give 5 days of high dose of radiation, followed by 7 to 10 days waiting, and followed by surgery. That's the crux of short course. Long course versus short course, cost benefit, compliance will be better in short course. Acute toxicity has been noted in short course few of the trial more, and late toxicity is more in case of long course. Long course benefit is if it is a bulky tumor, if it is a T3D mesorectal fascia involving tumor, downsizing, downstaging is better in case of long course chemo-RT. So to understand the downsizing, if you see here the tumor is, this is a peritoneal reflection, the tumor is extending above the peritoneal reflection. But after giving chemo RT and evaluation of the chemo radiation effect, we can see that a significant shrinking of the tumor vertically. That's the downsizing. If you take a downstaging, you can see in this axial section, this is a tumor which is infiltrating a mesorectum. We can label this tumor as a T3C or D. After giving chemo RT, the tumor is limited to the lumen. It might be T3A. So this is a downstaging. Stage has decreased. Prior size has decreased. This stage has decreased. Both effects are predominantly seen in chemo RT, long course chemo RT, and nowadays we can see in short course and long delay with chemotherapy, that is rapido trial, we can see this. The total neoadjuvant therapy approach, this concept has been now popularized with the rapido trial and also short course long delay with chemotherapy. They are popularizing this concept. The concept is nothing but give all the radiation as a short course with completion of chemotherapy and go for the surgery. The intention behind this is the locally advanced any malignancy, we will plan for both radiation. If you take a breast or anything, radiation and chemotherapy, both we give as earliest as possible. If we are planning for long course therapy in case of the rectal malignancy, in fact, 1.5 months of the initial neoadjuvant therapy and surgery followed by 1 month break, almost 4 months patient is delaying the chemotherapy. We are not at all targeting the metastatic component. For that reason, now what they are recommending is go for radiation for local sterilization, complete the chemotherapy for distant metastasis so that you do surgery. After that, everything will be over. After that, nothing need to be given. This trial result are awaiting. And also has been proposed in case of long course also, we can complete like chemotherapy, give for the complete chemotherapy first, followed by long course chemo RT radiation, waiting for the 6 to 8 weeks, followed by the surgery. So that is the total neoadjuvant concept for the CA rectum. Benefit of total neoadjuvant therapy is a high rate of pathological completion response. We are waiting for longer period. We are tackling potential micromets which are missed if we are going only for neoadjuvant RT or short course RT or long course chemo RT. Improvement of the tolerance of the chemotherapy is better. Post-surgically, patient tolerance for chemotherapy is less and relapse rates are more, which will be very less if we are going completely prior only. Increased resectability rate has been noted with the total neoadjuvant therapy and also the minimizing period of ileostomy. If you take any case of long course chemo RT patient and landing into ultra low and having ileostomy, patient has to wait at least 4 months to complete the chemotherapy, at least 1 month of gap to heal the, to go away the chemotherapy effect, and then we'll take for ileostomy. That ileostomy period we can minimize if we are going for total neoadjuvant therapy. So we are having many radiation approach, many surgical approach, how to go outwards. There is a two concept. One is a US based approach and other is a European approach. US based approach, mostly all of the center following this, that is if there is a T3 or N plus or locally unresectable tumor, we plan for neoadjuvant chemo RT and after that we'll go for the surgery. Or anything lesser than that, we'll plan for directly surgery. This is being given in NCCN and most of the units are following this. But the present concept has been mentioned by the European approach that deal the tumor as a good, bad and ugly. Anything mesorectal fascia negative without involving mesorectal fascia, no extramural invasion, node negative, Mets negative, T1 to T3 tumor or T3A and B tumor, those considered as a good tumor, low risk tumor. In these tumor, why unnecessarily to radiate the patient? In fact, even it is a T3, why we should radiate? That's a question, because local risk, recurrence risk is less than 10%. So they recommend to go ahead TME surgery directly without radiation. But if patient is having extramural invasion positive or nodal positive, or T3, B, C or D tumor, or low rectal tumor where mesorectum is less, T2, T3 tumor also, or T4 tumor, posterior vaginal wall only involving. In those scenarios, they mention it as an intermediate risk or bad tumors. In these patients, the risk of local recurrence is almost around 10 to 20%. For these cases, they recommend short course chemo-RT plus TME or long course chemo-RT plus TME, but recommended is short course chemo-RT TME suffice because the cost effective, we can go ahead at least for the surgery. But the society recommend if there is a mesorectal fascia involvement, threatened margin, or T4 tumor if other than the vaginal wall involvement or lateral node positive, in those patients, they recommend selectively labeling them as a high-risk ugly tumor, and they recommend long-course chemo-RT with TME because local recurrence in this patient, if we go for TME, is more than 20%. These recommends the long-course chemo-RT. So after finishing radiation, we'll go for the TME concept. If we see the evolution of the TME or surgical concept, it was initially perineal proctectomy, which was a very morbid procedure, followed by the abdominoperineal excision, that is APR. We should be thankful for Ernst Miles in 1908, William Ernst Miles, who started the APR. In fact, it is also following the TME principle, but that didn't popularize because of the morbidity, because of the other problem. But Bill Hill in 1982, who popularized the TME concept and clear ideas about how to do, what need to be done, and how we should proceed. The four important principles of the TME surgery are, we have to do circumferential sharp dissection. We have to preserve autonomic nervous system to avoid any sexual and urological complication. The margin should be negative. The margin is nothing but circumferential resection margin. This is the circumferential resection margin. In fact, this should be at least more than 1 mm from the node, tumor, or extramural invasion. It should be less, at least more than 1 mm. And if at all possible, if we are doing sphincter preserving surgery in those patients, we should plan for restoration of the GI continuity. These are the four basic principles of the TME surgery. TME, the two critical components of the TME oncological proctectomy is lateral margin. A blunt dissection, before the TME concept, there is a blunt dissection surgery for the rectum. In fact, which is associated with very high local recurrence, around 25 to 30%. And sharp dissection, local recurrence goes below 5 to 10%. In fact, if we add radiation, it will be less than 6%, which has been mentioned in the Dutch trial. The distal TME margin, at least 2 cm is recommended. If radiation done patient, 5 mm also negative margin is acceptable. Partial TME, if suppose tumor in the upper rectum or in the rectosigmoid, 5 cm margin, we have to give distal TME margin. The TME in the CA rectum, it improved the 5-year survival, in fact, which went up to the 75%, decreased the local recurrence up to 5%, and decreased the incidence of the impotence and bladder dysfunction from 85 to 15 and till the 50%, 15 to 50% has been mentioned. The surgery is a bit complex, but it can be doable, and operating time require more because we have to be patients while doing TME. Even single mistake of us, patient may land in lot of complication during surgery or recurrence post-surgery if TME is not good. And leaks rate are high if we have irradiated prior. Trauma rate may be needed if we are doing intrasphincteric or ultra-low resection dealing with a low rectal cancers. Different surgical concept has been mentioned. We'll just go one by one. There are rectal cancer surgery, sphincter preserving surgery, namely anti-resection where we do proctectomy, transection above the peritoneal reflection, leaving the cup of the rectum, and we are planned for colorectal anastomosis. It may be double staple techniques. And low anti-resection proctectomy with transection below the peritoneal reflection, mainly for the mid or lower rectal rectal tumor, leaving the cup of the rectum and doing the colorectal anastomosis. ultra low resection proctectomy with transection at the level of pelvic floor or at the level of puborectalis below the mesorectum, leaving the rectal mucosa only within the functional anal canal and doing colo anal anastomosis. It may be hand sewn or it may be stapled. Intraspentric dissection, proctectomy with transection of the rectum going below the pelvic floor and doing the colo anal hand sewing anastomosis is intraspentric resection. So in these all sphincter preserving procedure, we are taking the root of the, we are doing the either high or low ligation, and we are ligating the inferior mesenteric at the inferior margin of the pancreas and taking a part of sigmoid along with the rectum. Depending upon the type of surgery, either we are doing the part of the leaving part of the rectal tube or we are going to the pelvic floor and mobilize splenic flexure and conduit. We are anastomosing and doing colorectal or coloanal anastomosis, either stapled or hand sewn. Non-sphincter preserving surgery, the APR, if the tumor is very much abutting the sphincter complex where we are not able to get the negative margin, we need to do complete excision of the rectum anus, concomitant dissection through the abdomen and perineum. Perineum part is most important because it's the main culprit for the recurrence or other problem related to APR, and followed by the permanent end stoma in the left iliac fossa. Extralevator APR, when there is an invasion into the levator, we have to take either on the both side or either side of the levator muscle along with the tumor. And Hartmann procedure in a hemodynamically unstable septic patient where safety of the anastomosis is compromised, we can do the Hartmann procedure. We follow the LAR principle and we are not anastomosing. In this patient, we leave the anus intact and we do the stoma, and after 6 months we can think for doing Hartmann reversal. If we are planning for sphincter preservation surgery, we need a neorectal reservoir to do the restorative proctectomy, that is J pouch or either transverse coloplasty or side to end coloanal anastomosis. J pouch around 5 to 6 centimeters of the J limb will take, and anti-mesenteric border colotomy will do and stapled followed by the circular anastomosis. In transverse coloplasty, leaving distal 4 centimeters from the anastomotic area, we take a longitudinal incision along the tinea and we do transverse suturing followed by the coloanal or colorectal anastomosis. The side to the end anastomosis, we leave around 5 centimeters and we'll do side to end stapled or hand sewn anastomosis and closing the lumen on the other aspect. Low rectal or coloanal anastomosis, it has been noted that colonic pouch may be best for functional result, but long-term durability after 1 or 2 years, it's not been clear. So is the pouch or neorectum doing? It depends upon the surgeon preference. Even end-to-end anastomosis is also okay for the tumor surgery. We'll deal with APR. APR is abdominoperineal resection, where we will remove complete anus, rectum, and distal part of the colon along with the sphincter complex. And we do this surgery both abdominal perineal incision, and perineal surgery is more important to avoid the local recurrence in the future. And we make a permanent stoma on the left iliac fossa. The rationale behind the APR is tumor in the low rectum, that is without having peritoneal covering or 5 to 6 centimeters from the anal verge, is having, this has been noted that it is having aggressive pathology, that is poorly differentiated or perineural invasion, having higher incidence of mesorectal nodal involvement with very less amount of mesorectal tissue, higher lateral node involvement because very much close contact with the lateral pelvic floor, and high rate of local recurrence has been noted as compared to the mid and upper and also rectosigmoid tumor, and low 5-year survival has been noted in case of the low rectal tumor. So these tumors are something different than the upper and mid tumors. So this issue can be sorted out. So we need proper APR to take out the complete tumor. The issue related with the standard APR are wasting of the specimen. When you go at the liver top, the sphincters and specimen get wasted or coning will happen. It has been noted in the literature, the APR positive CRM rate are high and rectal perforation during APR is very ISI and higher rate of local recurrence as compared to upper and mid rectal surgery during the APR. This can be overcome by doing ELAP, that is extra levator APR, which may be a better option. Standard APR, in standard APR, we come from the above part, we go and then we cut the external sphincter and we take out the complete anus and the rectum. But in case of the extra levator APR, bit higher side, we'll stop the dissection and from the perineal part, we go into and we take along with the either both side or either one side of the levator which is involved. The specimen will be conical in case of the levator, wasting will be there at this level, but in case of extra levator, the specimen will be cylindrical. So if you see, this is a specimen of the wasted specimen of the APR. If you see, this is a specimen with a part of the levator is along with the specimen that is a cylindrical resection APR. Standard APR resection margin is coned, wasted at the levator, a level of levator. Preserving the pelvic floor structure will happen, but specimen is wasted and oncologically it may be issue because of positive CRM margins. If we plan for extra levator APR, that is ELAP, the wide resection of the levator is performed and specimen will be cylindrical and negative CRM rate is higher, but associated problem of wound closure, wound infection, and sometimes we may need a mesh to close the defect done after ELAP. The tumor specific approach, whether should do APR for all the CA rectum which is needing or we should do the ELAP. ELAP is a very morbid procedure and it should be done by the good colorectal surgeon who is well versed. But if we are planned, ELAP should be done selectively, patient who is having invasion of the external sphincter or involvement of the levator or margin threatened MRI. Otherwise, need of ELAP, those other than this, APR may be suffice if we are doing proper surgical dissection from the perineal aspect. Another concept is intersphincteric resection. If it is a low rectal tumor, less than 1 centimeter from the anorectal ring or less than 5 mm from 5 centimeter from the anal verge, all these tumor traditionally going for the APR. But if we see APR, there is a high rate of perforation and positive resection margin is higher in APR. Even if you take a low tumor of T2, T3A tumor also, this problem has been found. But if you go for the cylindrical ELAP, extra levator APR, procedure is very morbid, associated complications are higher. So is there any way in between managing this low rectal cancer tumor? This is the most controversial part. So Rulius has come with a classification. How should we plan based on the MRI? What they do, they have divided into type 1 supraanal tumor. If we see this tumor is supraanal, at least 1 centimeter from the, this is the anorectal ring, 1 centimeter above the anorectal ring. So these patients can safely go for colo anal anastomosis with ultra low resection. When we do ultra low resection, we can do stapled or Hanson anastomosis without any problem. If suppose this patient is having type 2 death is juxtaanal, means from the anorectal ring on the MRI is less than 1 centimeter, in those patients juxtaanal tumor, we need a partial intersphincteric resection. Our surgical margin should go beyond the pelvic floor and from the perineal, from the dentate line, we should cross internal sphincter, cut the internal sphincter at the dentate line, above the dentate line and take out the specimen as complete. So this is a supraanal or juxtaanal patient. In this patient, we can do partial intersphincteric or coloanal anastomosis with ultra-low resection. If it is a type 3 tumor, intraanal tumor, where internal sphincter, the tumor is invading the sphincter, in those patients, we can go from the complete intersphincteric. We go into the intersphincteric groove, take out the complete internal sphincter and do the coloanal anastomosis. Although this patient may have bit of more large score, but also it is acceptable because this patient are not having permanent stroma. If it is a type 4, the transanal tumor that is involved in the internal sphincter and also external sphincter, in those patients, abdominal perineal resection is better approach because we cannot prevent the permanent stoma in this patient. Type 3 patient, if the sphincter tone is good, patient is acceptable, and last score has been well explained and counseled to the patient, we can consider total intrasphincter. If external sphincter tone is bad, previously operated patient, or patient is not accepting the Lars syndrome, in those patients, APR can be done. By this way, even in the low rectal cancer, we can decrease the rate of APR. Now we will deal with the transanal TME. This is a new upcoming right now. Anthony Lisi, who has popularized this technique. This is nothing but the sphincter preserving surgery, which involves the combination of the abdominal and transanal endoscopic approach. Mainly, it is done to overcome the limitation of standard TME in some challenging scenario where we struggle by doing the lap TME. What are those scenarios? Narrow pelvis, male patient, bulky mesorectum, having previous irradiation, badly irradiated, advanced tumors are there, high BMI is there, or bulk of the tumor is there. In those patients, doing lap TME and going below the mid rectum and to the low rectum is a bit critical. In those patients, if we do TATME, will be very easy. So transabdominal assistant will do high ligation of IME, mobilization of complete splenic flexure, and complete the superior portion of the TME. And transanal team, which will do complete rest of the part of the TME and deliver the specimen transanally, and they do either stapled or Hanson anastomosis depending upon the length of the rectum left. The steps are, we will do the bursting incision, we'll mark the rectotomy incision, and followed by we'll go for the rectotomy, and we'll go into the proper TME flame from the anal region, and we'll join both the plane, we'll take out the specimen, we'll do either colorectal or coloanal Hanson or stapled anastomosis. So after surgical concept, it's most important to know that whether we have done proper surgery, proper TME or not, that should be noted by the both pathologist with photograph along with the surgeon, and should comment properly without any bias. The mesorectal dissection grade complete or good plane means if we see the glistening complete mesorectal fascia without any major irregularity, even it is there, it is less than 5 mm, without any coning at the distal margin. If it is a near complete or moderate plane, that is a bulk of the tumor, moderate bulk of the mesorectum, it's not full bulk, and there is some coning is happening, and exposure of the fascia has happened, but muscle is not exposed. This is the near complete TME. Incomplete or bad TME or poor plane when muscle is exposed, that is irregular defect in the mesorectum when muscle tube is exposed, that is a bad TME. So is there any way to avoid this? We have seen the many surgical aspect, but all the surgery are associated with some morbidity or there is chance of leak, everything we have seen. Is there any way to avoid this morbid surgical procedure? That's the main question which is evolving in this last decade. The chemo-RT followed by surgery, it's a standard therapy. But local excision for early tumor, T1, N0 tumor, or wait and watch for the patient who are clinical responders are the other alternative where, in spite of rectal cancer, we can avoid the rectal morbid surgery. So intention behind this is better quality, achieve the better quality of the better quality of life for the patient without compromise the oncological safety in the rectal cancer. Let deal with local excision and wait and watch. These are upcoming and very favorite topics. We will just deal bit in next few slides. Local excision. Why local excision? With increased amount of colorectal cancer, screening has rampantly increased in last decade, and the detection rate of early colorectal cancer has went up to 10 to 15%. early colorectal or early rectal cancer are nothing but cancer which are limited to bowel wall without any node. In these patients, if we plan for proper local excision with any of the modality, the cure rates are as comparable with standard proctectomy or standard TME. And also with the proper oncological safety, we can maintain the good quality, we can avoid the most expensive major surgical resection for the rectum. So local excision can be transanal excision, or total endoscopic microsurgery, transanal endoscopic microsurgery, and transanal minimal invasive surgery. So we'll see what is there, transanal excision or transanal microsurgery or transanal minimal invasive surgery. Transanal excision can be done up to 7 to 8 centimeter with exposure by using Lone Star. TEM surgery, it tumor has to be above 4 centimeter, and if the extent is up to 15 centimeter can be dealt with TEM. TEM is, it can be even lowermost tumor where combined hybrid, just do the TAE and superior margin, we can deal with the TEM. Is any inferior margin up to 15 centimeter upper rectum, we can deal with the TEM. Is the tumor dependent position in TAE TEM, which need, if it is a tumor anteriorly, we need a prone position. If tumor posteriorly, we need a lithotomy position. But TAM is, there is a flexibility in lithotomy position, any site of the tumor we can deal. The platform for the TAE and TEM is a rigid. For TAM is, it is a flexible platform because it's based on the gel port and routine conventional instrument. Because of conventional instrument, cost of TAM is low. And view in the TAM is, it uses normal laparoscopic instruments along with a laparoscopic camera, and only gel port we are putting on the transanal region. So view is 360 degree we can achieve in the TAM is, but the oblique one view we cannot achieve in the TAM because of that 220 degree, and in TAE we are getting only 180 degree view. So indication of local excision, less than 3 centimeter diameter of the tumor, less than 30% of the circumferential involvement, and within 10 centimeter of the wall. Anal verge, tumor should be within 10 centimeter, and tumor should be freely mobile. Imaging based, the limited to submucosa, that is T1 only, and involvement of node should be absent. Well-differentiated, moderately differentiated tumor, absence of lympho-vascular invasion and perineural invasion. These are the 10 indications for local excision, and there should not be any mucinous or signet cell component. Additional indications, a tumor high up, a mid-rectum, higher rectum can be considered with advancement in the local excision modality, that is a TAMIS. T2N0 rectal cancer, very good responder to chemo RT, which can be considered in a trial based, or patient is morbid who is not going to tolerate a morbid rectal surgery, and patient unfit for abdominal surgery, can we opt the local excision option. If we have done local excision, what are the indication for formal TME, that is complete total mesorectal proctectomy, when it is needed? If tumor turns to be Haggart 4 in case of pedunculated polyp, Kukuchi 3 in case of the non-pedunculated polyp, if there is an angiolymphatic invasion is seen in the biopsy, or invasion of the muscularis propria T2, in those patients we should plan for formal resection. Adenoma grade 3, grade 4, poorly differentiated. If specimen is fragmented, we are not able to find out the posterior margin or posterior positive resection margin within 2 mm or quaternary burnt area. If we are having tumor cell, those cases we should plan for the TME to avoid further recurrence in that patient. Last concept, wait and watch. Wait and watch is a recently upcoming concept. To understand wait and watch, we need to understand the complete response. Clinically complete response is around 50% if we have chemo RT, that is long course chemo RT. What is clinical complete response? That is nothing but replacement of the tumor bed by the scar or normal appearing mucosa, on the MRI grading or on the endoscopy, if we have that is a clinical responder, these patients we can plan for the wait and watch policy. And pathological complete response, absence of neoplastic cell in the surgical resection specimen after giving chemo RT, those are observed around 10 to 20% of the patient who has underwent chemo RT. Why we have to think about the wait and watch? Because 10 to 20% of the patient, we are aware that those patients will go for the complete pathological response. Pathological response means we have done proctectomy after chemo RT, but there is no tumor cell we have found on the specimen. And local recurrence in this patient has been seen that it is very, very less. It is less than 1%. And 5-year survival is as good as more than 90% after proctectomy. But if we are landing into the proctectomy, morbidity, mortality are associated, which is standard there for the proctectomy. Whether we can avoid this? Yeah, we can. We can avoid this not by doing not surgery without compromising any surgical oncological safety. Professor Angelita Bergama, this is from Brazil. Their group first device coined this non-operative management by Nakagawa, but popularized by Bergama, and they have found good result around 70% avoiding or preserving the rectum. The potential gain by avoiding the proctectomy is morbidity will be reduced, quality of life of the patient will be very good. The potential surgical cost or ICU cost or associated with the issue will be less if we avoid the proctectomy and we follow the patient for the wait and watch policy. So if it is a locally advanced rectal cancer and if we have given local long course chemo RT, traditionally what we follow is we go for the TME irrespective of the clinical response. But in wait and watch policy, we have to see the clinical response by doing digital proctological digital examination, proctoscopic examination to visualize, scopy to know if it is a upper or mid rectum, and along with the MRI grading to note that this is a well responder or there is no tumor. If suppose there is a complete clinical response or it might be an incomplete clinical response. If it is an incomplete clinical response, that is around 60%, those patients straight away plan for TME surgery. But if it is a complete clinical response, wait and watch policy is applicable in presence of expertise. If we are planned for wait and watch policy, suppose during the period of follow-up patient has recurrence which has been picked up by the endoscope or proctoscope or digital examination or imaging, those patients should go TME surgery, or if there is no recurrence should continue for wait and watch policy throughout the life. So wait and watch policy, what are the challenges? The correlation between clinical complete response and pathological complete response. We have seen that clinical complete response is around 40 to 50%, but it's not same as a pathological because only half of the patients are having a real complete response. The correlation preoperatively is not happening exactly what is expected to happen on the pathological complete response. The optimal follow-up schedule has been not yet standardized, but it is a very stringent follow-up schedule. Issue regarding failed wait and watch protocol. It has been noted in early phase that if the failed protocol and irradiated tissue doing surgery later period is associated with more complication has been told. Lack of evidence of oncological safety. It is a still evolving concept. There is no good study to tell that it is a very much oncologically safe. And concern about the false negative imaging. If we are doing imaging based on the imaging and endoscopy, we are following the patient. We are not aware that exactly patient has a very well responded or he has started or she has started with recurrence. So NCCN mentioned that at present, it is a not standard of care, but potential option for long course chemo RT patient or locally advanced CA rectum patient who has underwent long course chemo RT and came with complete response, these patients we can consider as a potential option in the future, or clinical scenario where patient is a clinical responder but not a fit patient for the surgery, we can follow them, wait and watch, and we can give an option for the patient. So at last, to know about the rectal cancer, we should decide based on the local recurrence, distant mets, and quality of life. These are the three parameters we have to think every possible option. So we should have a good grasp of the knowledge about the different rationale for the treatment and available supporting evidence, so that we should be able to defend ourselves in the court of law. And we should tailor the option based on the characteristic of the patient, willingness of the patient, and characteristic of the tumor. Thank you. Any question regarding our presentation, I would be happy to answer.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, this marks the end of our webinar. We would like to express our sincere gratitude to Dr. Samrat Jankar for giving us his time to provide us with this informative lecture. We'd like to send our greetings to our senior surgeons attending this lecture being Professor Salman Hisseleim Al Hussein, Professor Al Rashid, Mr. Omar Al Farouk, Ms. Reem Belila, Mr. Nadir Hilal. I would also like to send our greetings to other
Sir, voice is cracking.
Welcome all of you. Welcome our senior consultant. Welcome Mr. Suleiman, Professor Suleiman Hussein. You are welcome.
Hello.
Hello, sir. Hello, sir.
This is the first time I'm one of the colorectal surgeons in Khartoum here.
Okay, sir. And
thank you very much. Thank you very much for a very informative, brilliant presentation.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
And we really enjoyed it, and a lot of skills and knowledge in the presentation. Our experience here, I think we go back, there is a lot of observation common between our patients in Sudan and India.
Yes.
Epidemiologically, most of our patients here are young patients. And
yes,
actually,
sir,
more than 40% of our patients are below 50 years of age. And most of our patients present with an advanced cancer, locally advanced cancer.
Yeah, it's same in our India also, sir.
Yeah. And so in the rectum in particular, almost very rarely you see a T1 or a T2 tumor. So most of our tumors are T3 and T4 tumors.
Yes, sir.
And in most of the time now, in the last 10 years, we are adopting a policy of neoadjuvant therapy for almost all our patients, because we are not seeing much of an early tumors. And we are having an excellent result from sphincter preserving surgery, doing double stapling techniques. And we ended with having good number of patients with complete clinical response, as well as complete partial clinical response. But
sorry, sir, voice is cracking, sir.
We notice in particular in observation in the females whom had long course of chemoradiotherapy. And almost those patients usually are in the reproductive age. But unfortunately, most of the time following the long range, course of chemoradiotherapy, they ended with ovarian failure. And most of the time you ended with having surgery, complete recovery, and the oncological response is excellent. But the quality of life is dictated by secondary or primary infertility. We opted sometimes to bring some protection for the ovary, but unfortunately, it didn't work. I'm not sure whether you are observing this in your setup of your patients, and what is your advice for such young female patients? And now we are advocating other long chemo radiotherapy regimen for hoping for complete pathological response. This is one point. The other point about non-responders. We are seeing some patients, they receive the chemo radiotherapy and there is no response. They are young, fit patients, no metastasis, but they ended with having almost a frozen pelvis. And so we tried in some of them, we tried some pelvic fixation, but I think these are very, an operation is associated with large morbidity and bad quality of life. And almost always our results are not very promising. So, and you ended with having a patient with a local advanced cancer. He's well, he looks well, he's fit, but unfortunately he's having a frozen pelvis. He's having a functioning stomach. And most of those times they survive for good time because it is not a metastatic disease. It is a locally advanced disease. And I am not sure about your experience with such type of patients, the non-responders, clinically fit, as well as I said, with generally well, with no evidence of distant metastasis, but it is just a frozen box and the pelvis is frozen and the patient, most of the time, strange enough, even they are not having such much of pain. But only they end with having what you rectum, your finger in the rectum, you find that just a very hard, rocky mass. And whether you have a look at the laparoscope or you go in, you find that there is no way at all to find your way through any anatomy. So what is your experience of such patients? Thank you very much.
Really thankful. A lot of wonderful clinical thought you have put in, sir. It shows that it's a great experience you are having about the rectal cancer management. We also having quite number of young patients who are coming here with the tumor. In these patients, it's quite difficult to manage these patients. But these patients, most of the patients who are having frozen pelvis or non-responder land with exantation. I think present Rapido trial, what they are coming totally neoadjuvant where they are increasing resectively, I think, which may be a potential for the benefit in these patients where initially only we feel that it is infiltrating on the surrounding structure or surrounding structure is getting fixed or we are feeling that it is quite aggressive malignancy in young 40-year guys. In those patients, I think total neoadjuvant therapy may be a further potential advantage in the future. And till now, whatever we have seen, quite few number of patients, such a patient whom we are landing in exantation surgery, which is quite more morbid as compared to other proctectomy. Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Sorry, I didn't catch your first part about the protection of the ovaries and the problem of primary and secondary infertility in young females following the long course of chemo radiotherapy. And if you have had any experience with this. And if I might add another question about extended APR, about what do you do for the perineal wound? Do you do one stage plastic reconstruction of the perineum? Or you do it in a two-stage, or do you have a couple with the involvement of the plastic surgery when you do an extended area?
Most of the time we are closing the perineum extra levator. Frankly speaking, my personal experience, whatever I have been in the one of the good institute in Jammu Hospital where I studied my DNB super specialty, where we landed hardly one or two patients only extraperitoneal resection. The experience about the extraperitoneal resection of mine is bit on the lower side only, sir. But whatever we have done primary closure only with adding the mesh, non-absorbable composite mesh we have used. Hello, sir. Hello, sir.
I think we lose the connection with Prof. Suleiman due to internet connection. Welcome anyone. Anyone have any comment or question? Please unmute yourself and ask the question.
I think it's a wonderful society and you people are doing a commendable job. I really enjoyed the session today evening.
Prof. Suleiman, if you have any addition.
I think a lot of professors are there. Their input also will help for us youngsters to understand better.
Okay, back again, yeah?
Yes, sir.
And I think in this part of the world, we probably have to prioritize the treatment according to the available resources.
Yes,
and in particular in Sudan, we are, as we said, 60% of our colorectal cancer are rectal ones. And as I said, most of them, they are T3, T4 tumor, that need radio chemotherapy. And unfortunately, our oncology services are not that available in all parts of the country. Probably we are having 3 centers in all Sudan to provide such treatment. So most likely we need to prioritize which patient actually is going to benefit from the chemo radiotherapy, not depending on a clinical criteria, but probably depending on availability of resources. And most of the time we ended with the patient, they may have had a protracted course of chemo radiotherapy because of some problems with the machines, a problem of availability of the service or availability of the drugs. And sometimes you get an extended treatment beyond beyond the 6 or 8 weeks. And this brings me to and from here we notice that those patients who've had a protracted course of chemo radiotherapy for 3 months or whatever, even if it is interrupted, even they do better than those who have had a short course of chemo radiotherapy. And this brings me to the concept of rectal surgery. Going back to the anal surgery. Anal surgery, as we know in the past, the treatment is abdominal perineal resection. When they started neoadjuvant therapy, they noticed the good response, and now the standard treatment is chemoradiotherapy. And now with an advance of, as you rightly said, with the advance of technology in chemoradiotherapy, and advancing techniques. Do you think that we are for rectal cancer, probably in the future, the prime treatment may be chemoradiotherapy and surgery will come next? Still, there are a lot of results coming waiting for watch and watchful policy. And the numbers are increasing now. So what I am feeling is that probably in 10, 15 years' time or so, the standard treatment for rectal cancer might not be surgery. It may be just chemo radiotherapy, similar to anal cancer surgery, though the two tumors are different. And I think the same thing is observed in the esophagus now. I think our colleague doing upper GIT surgery with adenocarcinoma. Also, they are observing with more use of neoadjuvant therapy, they are using seeing much of complete clinical responses, and when they operate, complete partial clinical response. So do you feel that the same trend is heading towards rectal cancer surgery?
Yes, sir. Rectal surgery, I think a lot of neoadjuvant and chemotherapy trials are going on. And more initially, it was there that people are very reluctant for wait and watch. Now more people are going towards the wait and watch. If the quality of evidence is falling on the non-surgical management, and if it is getting more and more, the major problem of non-operative management is they are not able to calculate proper clinical complete response. If imaging or endoscopy getting you all like diffusion weighted images or contrast images in the imaging, and if they are getting more and more accurate knowledge about the clinical response, in those scenario, it may pendulum shift towards the non-surgical management. And I would not surprise in 10 years if the evolution is happening in the PET or MRI, diffusion-weighted MRI, and giving better clinical response criteria or better follow-up criteria, it may shift towards the non-operative management like anal cancers. It's really true. And at the end, if the patient is getting benefited by something, which if we are doing surgery or not doing surgery, at the end, our main concern is the patient. If they are getting better treatment at the good clinical evidence, then I think it may come up. And really, it's true. And it's really good thought you put, sir. Professor, you have put really good thought.
Can I come in?
Welcome, Professor Rashid.
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Well, thank you, Mr. Dr. Jankar.
Thank you, sir.
I really enjoyed your presentation. I missed the first half because of the internet interruption, but I think it gave us a very good summary at the end. Well, I think, well, I'm not practicing colorectal now. It used to be in the good old days. I think Suleiman is doing most of this work now, but I think patients usually, I mean, the headache is that I don't want a permanent colostomy. This is number one. And I think surgeons also would like to have this. So what are the, I mean, guarantees that, I mean, patient pushing for not having a permanent colostomy before operation? So how can you really guarantee that? And I think the most depressing thing for the surgeon is to find that resection margins have got malignant cells. I think this is really a big headache. And the other thing is that the sphincter is not functioning or you have got some degree of incontinence. Well, the last question would be that your patients who are coming with very early tumors that probably have a local resection, what sort of patients? Are they educated? Are they medical? I mean, what is special about those patients who present very early? Because for a long time in this country, we used to have this problem. Anybody who has got a bleeding PR is diagnosed as hemorrhoids and treat it until later on it is discovered that it is a malignancy. So what is, I mean, really, I mean, getting this early case, is it screening, is it, what sort of approach did you have?
Actually, in India, frankly speaking, we are also having more of locally advanced malignancy rather than early tumor. Early tumor and other intersphincteric resection or TA-TME, these are the things we are reading. For practically speaking, we are also having more of locally advanced tumor only. And at the end of the day, if we are, I am the surgeon, I am operating for the patient of the rectal cancer, I will be always want to be on the safer side rather than having positive margin. If tumor is 2 centimeter above, if we are on the surgical table, confident to go ahead doing the anastomosis, we'll plan. Otherwise, rather than making the resection margin and going for again surgery, it's always better to go for the bit of more extended surgery and plan for the APR or extra levator APR. Regarding other one question, sir, the perineal stoma, and it's really depressing for the patient, and post-operative counseling is a lot of difficulty for high grade of Last syndrome. If patient poor function is there, definitely the patient should not be planned for anything fancy, intersphincteric resection or even for the ultra low resection. If patient is quite educated and having good tone, then only it can be. But rather than having the perineal stoma passing multiple time, loose stool, not able to have continence, rather than that, planning for the APR is always better than the perineal stoma, sir. I would not consider those patients where the sphincter weakness is there, previous surgery has been done in the anal region, or not well counseling patient. I will definitely put forward that it's rather than the perineal stoma, better to have a APR where quality of life is better. Personally, quite number of patients we do operate in our center. I just moved from the GEM hospital where good amount of colorectal work we used to do last 1 month only, and during COVID here I shifted in the Symbiosis. Still I have to start here, but whatever last 5 year experience at the GEM, we selectively take for intersphincteric young patients only where we can give a good continence. If large score is expected higher or patient is going for the perineal stoma, in spite of patient is asking to preserve the sphincter, we explain that quality of life of the perineal stoma is far, far worse than the your permanent stoma. And for you, you should consider the having the APR or extra levator APR and permanent stoma, which will be better quality of life, sir.
No frozen section.
Usually, if at all planning for intersphincteric resection, we plan for frozen section, sir. If a doubtful margin is there, we plan for the frozen section, sir.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Any comment, any question? Please, anyone, unmute yourself.
When we no. want questions from the residents.
We are welcome, all of the residents. If anyone have any question, please unmute yourself. I think no more question.
Thank you, Mohammed sir. It's a wonderful okay. society.
Okay, on behalf of Sudanese Surgical Club, we really thank Dr. Samrat Jankar for this very nice and elaborative session and very interactive talk from all of our eminent surgeons. Really thank you very much, and we hope to see you in next lecture. So, thank you very much.
Thank you. Good night. Thanks, Lord.
Good night.